The Lord be with you. Greetings, everybody, and welcome. Thank you for joining us today as we have our virtual worship service. To those people still sitting tucked up in bed with a cup of coffee, enjoying worship, welcome to you especially, and to others who join later in the day. When the weather's warmed up a little bit, maybe, I suppose. Whatever time of day you choose to tune in, we are grateful, and thank you for tuning in, and thank you for reminding us that we are a body, that we remain one. Lockdown, pandemic cannot really separate us. We are united by God. I have to say that I certainly am enjoying the fact that the temperature seems to be rising a little bit. It's light earlier in the morning now, so that brings a sense of joy and comfort in its own way as well. So welcome, and may you be blessed wherever you find yourself this morning, today, worshiping with God's people. And as always, as we come together, whenever we come together, we come to bring God our praise and our thanksgiving. So we begin our worship by saying, praise the Lord. Praise Him, you servants of the Lord. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be His name, now and forever.
Am I more than just the sum of every high? Australia, God, you have every victory. When I think I'm weak, and you say I'm held, when I am falling short, when I don't belong, oh, you say I'm yours, and I believe, oh, I believe what you say of me, oh, I believe.
We offer together the collect for purity. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. God has promised forgiveness to all who truly repent, who turn to Christ in faith, and who are themselves forgiving. So we spend a moment in quiet as we bring ourselves before God now, acknowledging that we are sinners, but being reminded that God loves us. And so to this loving God, we confess and we just come seeking His goodness, His mercy. Let's be still for a few moments. How comforting, how encouraging to know that God loves us so much that He sent His only Son so that we might know His forgiveness, His mercy, and His grace. So let us confess together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, in penitence we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have left undone. For the sake of your Son, Christ, our Lord, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on us, pardon our sins and set us free from them. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We offer together the collect for today. Let us pray. God of awesome wonder, bless us with bold belief, even in the darkness of the night and the assault of life's storms, that we may be messengers of your peace and justice, in the name of the one whom winds and waves obey, and who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
This morning's reading is taken from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 8, reading from verses 40 to 56. Now when Jesus returned, the crowd welcomed him, for they were all waiting for him. And there came a man named Jairus, who was a ruler of the synagogue. And falling at Jesus' feet, he implored him to come to his house, for he had only a daughter, about 12 years of age, and she was dying. As Jesus went, the people pressed around him, and there was a woman who had had a discharge of blood for 12 years. And though she had spent all her living on physicians, she could not be healed by anyone. She came up behind him and touched the fringe of his garment, and immediately her discharge of blood ceased. And Jesus said, "Who was it that touched me?" When all denied it, Peter said, Master, the crowds surround you and are pressing in on you. But Jesus said, Someone touched me, for I perceive that power has gone out from me. And when the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him, declared in the presence of all the people why she had touched him, and how she had been immediately healed. And he said to her, Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. While he was still speaking, someone from the ruler's house came and said, Your daughter is dead. Do not trouble the teacher anymore. But Jesus, on hearing this, answered him, Do not fear, only believe, and she will be well. And when he came to the house, he allowed no one to enter with him except Peter and John and James and the father and the mother of the child. And all were weeping and mourning for her. But he said, Do not weep, for she is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But taking her by the hand, he called, saying, Child, arise. And her spirit returned, and she got up at once. And he directed that something should be given her to eat. And her parents were amazed, but he charged them to tell no one what had happened.
And I want to invite our preacher for today to the pulpit, the virtual pulpit. Ryan is sharing God's word with us this morning, so I hand over to him. And may God bless us as we continue to reflect upon his word.
Good morning, church. Thank you for joining us this morning. Thank you, Sam, for that swift handover. I hope that you're all blessed and well. So this morning's scripture is actually quite a bit. I hope that you are blessed by this, and yeah, let's dive in. So the scripture starts with Jesus returning from a trip, and the trip itself that Jesus is returning from actually plays a big role in today's text. So to understand a lot of what happens in the scripture today, we have to go back and think of what the time was like. And we have to think about the Jews who had considered a lot of things unclean according to the law. And you can find those things in Leviticus. So today they still declare a lot of those things unclean. Things such as touching a dead body, consuming certain animals such as pigs, touching the people who has a skin disease with leprosy, people who bleed, hemorrhaging, also a woman who gives birth, and also a woman who's on a menstrual cycle. So hence why I said where Jesus is coming from is important, because where he came from was a place where there was a man with unclean spirits. He chased the unclean spirits into pigs, and that gives us so many clues as to why it was unclean. One, it was a place where pigs were, so it means it wasn't a place where the Jews were, because they wouldn't consume pigs. There's a pig farm, so that's unclean. Jews wouldn't eat together with any other people like the Samaritans or the Gentiles, so they wouldn't mix because they considered them unclean. Secondly, the man who was possessed, demon possessed, he also had unclean spirits, so he was also unclean. Then where he was situated was like a burial ground. In these caves there were where people were buried, and again the dead, unclean space. So this was a triple threat, and Jesus returns from that place across the waters when they asked him to please leave. And he comes and he meets a crowd. So Jesus technically was unclean when he came there, and he was going to touch other people would make them also unclean. So Jesus comes and there's a crowd, and this man Jairus comes and falls at his feet. This man was a prominent man, a religious leader in the temple, and the fact that he came to Jesus meant a lot, because it meant that this man as a religious leader had nowhere else to turn. He had no one else he could depend on to help him. He had nowhere else to go. He had this distress in his voice coming to Jesus saying, "My daughter is about to die. Please come and help." This father's distress is something that Jesus is moved by. And therefore, they start moving towards Jairus' place to go and save his daughter. But at the same time, something else, or should I say someone else, is at play. We are introduced to this woman abruptly in scripture, this woman who bleeds for 12 years. Out of nowhere, it's just introduced in the text. And the writer does something very intentional. A bulb must go on, a light bulb must go on, when he sees this woman bleeds for 12 years and Jairus' daughter was 12 years old. This wasn't a coincidence. It meant that this event was related and will for all time be related. So, this woman was bleeding for 12 years, hemorrhaging for 12 years. Another light bulb should go on. She was unclean. So she was not to be touched. And so it means anybody who touches her would then also be unclean. But the writer adds something significant. He says that she paid a lot of physicians over the years to try and cure her. So she was either a prominent woman and somebody who had above average money because she could pay for all these medical bills. But with that comes the second thing. No one could cure her. So just like Jairus, she was desperate and was in need of something radical. She was in need of Jesus. So with this woman having this blood disease for 12 years, people would stay away from her because they knew who she was. It's been a long time. They knew she was unclean and they would stay out of the way. And Jesus was walking towards this place and she knew who Jesus was in this moment. And she thought, if I could just touch him, I would then be cured. And she made her way to the front of the crowd and she touches Jesus. But it wasn't actually as simple as that. A lot of times when you listen to the scripture, it was almost as if she just went through a few people, boom, and that's it. But there's important clues that take place that it wasn't that easy. One of the most important keys is where she touched Jesus, at the hem or at the fringe of his garment. That means at the bottom. And also something very important to hold in mind was that Jesus and Jairus were important people. They had people around him. So Jesus had his 12 disciples around him. Jairus had his people with him. And there was crowds going along with him. And these were a lot of people, a tight crowd, pushing and shoving, everybody wanting to see what's going to happen next, following Jesus and Jairus. They were moving as a unit and all tightly squeezed and everybody just curious as to what's happening next. So she was faced with this crowd seeing what's happening, and it wasn't an easy task to get to the front of that crowd. So she tried. Even though she knew she was unclean and she would be touching people who would then make them unclean and people would be steering away from her, she went for it. She went, she tried to get in there, shoving people, pushing through. But at the end, she realized she couldn't get to the front by this means because it was condensed. What she then did was go down and she got into the dirt and she started crawling. And as she was crawling, she was getting dirty, getting bruised, getting exhausted, because this was tiring, getting through this crowd on the ground, and she sees Jesus in sight. What she does then is she reaches out and touches the hem of his garment, and Jesus stops. He turns and then asks, "Who touched me?" The disciples then said to Jesus, "How can you ask this? There's a lot of people pushing up against us. How can you ask who touched you? And they weren't being ignorant, because it was actually a lot of crowds and a lot of people were touching Jesus. A lot of people were touching them. They were up close. But Jesus himself knew why he was asking this question. He asked this question because he knew who touched him. And he was calling her out. And he had a reason for this. He knew that she wasn't accepted in her society. He knew that she was unclean. But he also knew she was now healed. This woman realized that she was healed and this amazing thing happened to her. She then realized, oops, Jesus is calling me out. And if she wasn't afraid before about standing in front of Jesus, now Jesus is calling her out. And verse 47 says, when the woman saw that she could not remain hidden, she came trembling and falling down before him. She declared in the presence of all who were there why she had touched him. And she had been immediately healed. He said to her, daughter, your faith has made you well. In this moment, not only was she physically healed, but Jesus did so much more. Calling her out in front of all these witnesses, she was then declared clean and reestablished in society. Jesus shifted the power in that moment to her, making people recognize that now they can't treat her as an outcast anymore. There was nothing wrong with her. They needed to accept her back. He acknowledged the pain. He acknowledged the suffering. He acknowledged the freedom. He acknowledged or the lack of freedom. He acknowledged the stigma. He acknowledged how she valued herself. And in when she was touching her garment and him speaking out to her and saying, daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace. He restores her. We could take a moment and ask, why her? Why did she get healed? We can also ask, why did Jesus call her daughter? There's reasons for that. But I think what is important in this space is how Jesus responds to her. On this Women's Day, I would like to ask, how do we deem women? Most of us have probably heard of movements such as Me Too, Am I Next, and also Men Are Trash. And there's a lot of debate about it. Men are saying, no, I'm not that type of guy. I wouldn't do that. And pushing back. But it's not about that. These women and girls in our society often aren't hurt or abused by strangers. Often it's by their brothers, fathers, uncles, cousins, or family friends who they deem the same as family. Those are the people who abuse and hurt them. And to go with that is not just the crime that is horrendous, but also the stigma attached to it. They often need to live sheltered lives because people know it's like, that's that girl, and they have to almost like protect themselves or be ashamed of what they've been through. They also have to often stay quiet because it's either a prominent member in society or in the church or a family member. You shouldn't speak such things about that person. That person's very important. It could mean bad news for them. So you need to stay quiet. And that's a problem. And they also, if people find out, get shamed on social media, put onto the internet, and they can do nothing about it. Instead, they get blamed. It's like, look how you acted. Look what you've done. Look how you approached this person. And look how you are dressed. It's honestly shameful. I heard a story about a girl, and this girl is anonymous. I don't know this girl, but I heard the story from the priest. The intention of the story is not to shame or anything, but to actually highlight how profound I found the story. It inspired me, and I found it amazing. The story goes where the girl shared with her priest something that had happened to her. She was abused, and she felt like something was taken away from her, that she was proud of. She was keeping herself, and somebody took away something that was very important to her. She accepted that she can't get it back, but it really hurt. But what the priest told her was that she shouldn't allow that to dictate her life. She shouldn't allow that person to have ownership of that part of her life. She shouldn't allow that person to have that power over her. Instead, she should take it back. She should pray to God for healing and strength. And she should claim back her innocence for herself. So today I pray whoever sees this or hears this does not stray away from helping to uplift a girl or a woman, or stray away from helping a girl or a woman take back her dignity and fight against the unjust and unfair society. I pray that we stand together as men and hold each other accountable, because the women in our lives deserve this. They deserve to feel safe. They deserve to live the way God intended them to. We are all image bearers, and we cannot allow somebody else to feel less of an image bearer, because that's not how things go. I'm just going to hop back now to the journey where Jesus was on. And that's where he was on his way to Jairus' house after turning away from the woman and sending her off. Jairus' messenger actually intercepts him and says, "Don't bother the teacher any longer, your daughter has passed away." And this is striking, because this means that they didn't believe that Jesus could do anything about the situation. But Jesus responds by saying, "Do not fear, only believe, and she will be saved." And he responded to that in their lack of faith, which is actually the opposite to the woman, where the woman was full of faith. And the main argument about her being healed or power leaving Jesus to her instead of everybody else is because of her faith. And Jesus actually says to her, "Your faith has made you well." So they are back on their way to Jairus' place, and they encounter the wailers. So the wailers were these people who were mourning and crying and shouting and really bringing this atmosphere of sadness and of people needing to be mourning, and it's really a gloomy situation. And they were hired to do that often, to make this statement. And when Jesus got there, he actually told them that the girl is sleeping. And they didn't believe him. Instead, they laughed at him. They were like, "Are you really now? Is she sleeping?" And it's not because they were ignorant. They were hired to do these at funerals. They know a dead body when they see one. But they also didn't know Jesus, so they didn't know better. So Jesus sent them off. Jesus actually sent everyone off, and he brought into the girl's room three of his disciples and the girl's parents. And now again, in this moment, the light bulb should go on, because this girl, if she's dead, means that she's unclean. You're not supposed to touch a dead body. Instead, what does Jesus do? Verse 54 says, "But he took her by the hand and he called out, 'Child, get up.'" In Mark, it says, "Talita kumi," "Girl, stand up." They gave us something to eat, and they couldn't believe this miracle. And it says that the spirit came back. So Jesus, in this story, is not about what the world dictates. He's about restoring people. Jesus was never unclean. Instead, Jesus cleaned or cleansed. So all in all, if Jesus is in this restoration business, like in the story and special mentions such as Mary, where she washed his feet with these oils / perfume, and also the Samaritan woman at the well in John 4, we are then called into the same business as the followers of Christ. We need to acknowledge that often that business means that we then are called to take care of our women, children, the orphan, the poor, and the foreigner. That we need to stand up and say enough is enough. We need to restore the dignity and images, or God-breathed images, of our women and girls in our life. Amen. Erin will now lead us in a short prayer.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we pray for you to protect women and children in our country. Open their hearts to allow you in. Teach them to depend on you, to trust in you, and to walk in obedience. Let us women be a blessing to others. God has a special plan for each one of us. As a child of God, remember, Jesus is in you, with you, and for you. Amen.
Give thanks to God again. Lord, we thank you for your continued provision, especially during these days where so many people are struggling financially. Thank you for the generosity of people who are giving in cash and in kind to help those who are without an income as a result of this pandemic. Thank you for your people at Emmanuel, who even in these trying times are seeking to honor their financial commitments to your church. Continue to bless and to provide for your people. And may we always be aware that all things come from you and of your own do we give you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Beloved, may the rest of your Sunday be blessed as you maybe spend time at home with loved ones. May it be special. May you treasure these moments of being with loved ones. And may we continue to remember, especially the elderly who seem to be struggling because there's not a great deal of contact with family members. And also we've come to realize that this virus is having an impact on a lot of our senior citizens, especially in homes where our senior citizens are staying. So let's remember them and let us seek to stay safe and to protect ourselves and others during this pandemic. Now may the peace of Christ enfold us, may the love of Christ possess us, may the Spirit of Christ direct us. the joy of Christ be in us. Shalom.